Morning, everyone. Good morning. Nice to see you all today. You will note a rather pleasant change in the weather this morning. You can give the credit to me if you'd like. Anyway, we're not expecting any more rain during your stay, so that's good. And it should be in the 70s today and about 80 tomorrow, I think, so that's great. Without further ado, we're going to begin our session this morning, and I would like to ask Stacy Noam to come up and introduce our keynote speaker this morning. Stacy is a graduate of the MDiv program here at Notre Dame, 2005, and she is now the director of the Lay Ministry Formation Program, which is related to the MDiv program. So Stacy will introduce our keynoter.
Thank you, Mike. It is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Zeni Fox. My first encounter with Zeni was through her work, New Ecclesial Ministry, in 2002, when it was published and when I was beginning formation here in the Master of Divinity program. For the duration of my time in graduate study, that work remained the only source that spoke directly to the vocational reality of lay ecclesial ministry. And it was so prescient and prophetic that I thought Zeni Fox must be one of God's chosen mouthpieces. Indeed, Zeni served as an advisor to the Bishop's Subcommittee on Lay Ministry for 10 years as they developed co-workers in the Vineyard of the Lord. Since then, she has edited the works Lay Ecclesial Ministry, Pathways Toward the Future, and Called and Chosen Toward a Spirituality for Lay Leaders. Her theology and book reviews have been published in various pastoral journals, including Church, The Living Light, Liturgical Ministry, and Health Progress. She has received numerous academic distinctions and national awards, including two honorary degrees, the Gaudium et Spes Award from the National Association for Lay Ministry, the Wisdom and Service Award from St. John's University, and an award for faculty excellence from Seton Hall, where she serves as professor of pastoral theology. She lectures frequently throughout the country on lay ministry, lay spirituality, and lay leadership. I finally had the great honor of meeting Zeni in person for the first time just a month ago at St. John's at a symposium. And I was struck not only by her utter humility, but also her genuine interest in those around her. And not only in those on times at conferences where we're networking and mixing, but also in the quiet down times. More than once, I happened to glance up and chance to see her inviting people to sit at a table with her and inviting them into conversation. With that, and to continue our conversation here, I'm delighted to introduce to you Zeni Fox.
Good morning. Some introductions are a little overwhelming. I have to admit that one was, but I thank you, Stacy. So, I'm delighted to be here with you this morning. I'm also delighted for all of us that there was that happy change in the weather. Because yesterday I was at a graduation of my grandniece, I wasn't able to come in until late mid-afternoon. I was supposed to fly. And poor Father Connor has been worrying that I wouldn't get here, and I didn't know that he was following all the canceled flights in Chicago, but the airport in Newark figured out that since my flight was already delayed to Chicago, that it would be better if I not go there, where flights were being canceled, and instead come directly here. So about 5 hours later than I anticipated, I boarded a plane and got in very late last night to heavy weather. And then this morning, we're given this. So I'm delighted to be here. And I'm sorry I caused you worry. But lay ecclesial ministry is a topic that I have thought about a great deal. In fact, I've been immersed in it, since it is not only something I have researched, but I've taught many lay ecclesial ministers. I have had conversations with many, many more at conferences such as Stacy described. It is the lay ecclesial ministers who have posed to me, by their lives in ministry, many of the questions that I am still pondering. However, each time that I began to think about how to respond to the request to address the topic, lay ecclesial ministry as one flowering of baptismal witness, it was a conversation with Father David Power, the great 20th century liturgist, that kept coming to mind. First, the backstory on that. In August 2001, 10 theologians had been asked to spend 8 days together in Collegeville discussing papers we had prepared on lay and ordained ministry. We didn't present the papers. Rather, we pondered together what we had written. We then sought points of convergence, of consensus, seeking to articulate a contemporary theology of both lay and ordained ministry. There were 7 points of convergence. One was, baptism is an initiation into the life of Christ and the way of discipleship in the church, by which all participate in the mission of the church. It is the ground for all discussions of ministry. The most fundamental ordering of the church occurs in baptism. That was the consensus in the group. And at some point in that conversation of several days, David Power said, "As a church community, we will truly recognize this when we celebrate baptism with the same solemnity as we celebrate holy orders." I think you can understand why this comment has stayed with me these years, and why I invite you to ponder this question or this comment with me today. My presentation has 4 parts: a reflection on baptism, some stories about ritual, the emergence of lay ecclesial ministry, and some current developments in lay ecclesial ministry. So the first part, looking back to the beginning. Let's reflect briefly on the earliest writings of our church, things you're very familiar with. First, the letters of Paul. An early articulation of the theological meaning of baptism is developed by Paul, especially in 1 Corinthians, Galatians, and Romans. You know this text from Romans well, but listen and remember. "You were taught that when we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized in his death. In other words, when we were baptized, we went into the tomb with him and joined him in death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the Father's glory, we might live a new life. When Jesus died, he died once for all to sin. So his life now is life with God, and in that way, you too must consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive for God in Jesus Christ." In this passage, we hear that baptism initiates us into union with Christ, suffering and dying, something I will return to at a later point, and that it unites us with the risen Lord so that we may live a new life, including a life, quote, for God, which by implication describes sharing in the mission and ministry of Jesus. In Acts, we note again and again that baptism was central to the life of the earliest Christian communities. Chapter 2 describes Peter's preaching on Pentecost and concludes, "They were convinced by his arguments, and they accepted what he said and were baptized. That very day, about 3,000 were added to their number." In chapter 8, we read of Philip's preaching, and that, quote, "When they believed Philip's preaching of the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women." Paul himself was baptized by Ananias during his time of retreat after his encounter with the Lord on the road to Damascus. A sense of urgency is in the words recording this. "So he was baptized there and then." Paul, in turn, baptized. In Corinth, 12 men, already believers, quote, "were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, and the moment Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came down on them." And when Peter visits the house of Cornelius, a Roman centurion, the inclusion of the community of the baptized expands beyond the Jews. quote, "I had scarcely begun to speak when the Holy Spirit came down on them in the same way as it came down on us at the beginning. I realized then that God was giving them the identical thing he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. And who was I to stand in God's way?" Acts attests to this practice of administering baptism to groups and individuals who believed in Jesus Christ based on the preaching of the apostles. It's almost like a refrain sounded again and again in this story of the early church. A favorite early church writing of mine is the Didache, which some scholars date as early as 60 to 70 AD. I've always defined myself as a teacher, which is why this text for first century teachers is so important to me. It is very short, in my translation, less than 10 pages. It outlines the way of life Christians should follow and devotes 2 pages to beautifully describing the Eucharistic celebration. It also describes a ritual for baptism, saying in part, "Baptize as follows. After first explaining these points, baptize in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit in running water." All of these texts attest to the importance of baptism in the life of the early church, and central to my thesis, the importance of the ritual celebration of baptism. The texts do not offer the same evidence of the ritual celebration of holy orders. The New Testament certainly does tell us of Jesus calling disciples, and within that larger group, calling apostles. Further, it shows that the leadership of the 12 was central in the early life of the community. The pastorals, very late New Testament books, attest to a growing emphasis on the qualities that church leaders should have. The Didache also describes what qualities to seek in, quote, bishops and deacons, but gives much fuller descriptions of the teachers and prophets, clearly active in the communities the authors knew. The church's understanding of holy orders certainly developed over time, but in the early church, it was baptism and Eucharist which were most solemnly celebrated. A small digression. The sense of the solemnity with which baptism was celebrated during the first millennium can be seen when viewing the truly grand baptistries that were built, often adjacent to cathedrals. If you've traveled in Europe, you have seen these great buildings in Florence, in Pisa, in Rome, in Parma, Padua, or in Provence, Kiev, to name just some. Often catechumens were catechized within these buildings. And of course, baptism was celebrated by immersion. These beautiful structures remain to remind us of the solemn rituals that they housed for the first half of the church's life. Moving from the early period closer to our own time, I call this section 20th Century Snapshots. Okay. It's a family album, as you will see. My mother was born in 1915. Between her memory, shared in stories with me over the years, and my own, I would like to give some of these snapshots of the celebration of baptism during the middle of the 20th century and until today. My mother told me that she attended my baptism, this at a time when most mothers did not do so. She said it was a simple ritual. She also went to the baptisms of my 3 younger siblings, but she did not bring me, or even for the youngest, the others. The font was not in the main church, and certainly not in a grand baptistry. Again, simple rituals, certainly valued by the Catholic faithful, but without the solemnity attested to by our history. As we move into the time of after the council, Think about experiences you have had of baptism in this time. In the generation of my nieces and nephews, each of them was baptized with many extended family members and friends gathered round. At one, two older siblings carried the small banner they had made for their sister, celebrating this moment. That hung in their living room for years. At another, each of the elders present was asked to trace the sign of the cross on the foreheads of the infants. My bachelor uncle said that it was the most beautiful baptism he had ever attended, and I think it was because he was asked to participate, to be a part of it. And now another generation, the baptism of my grandnieces and my grandnephews. At one, the priest invited all the children present to gather around the baptismal pool at the front of the church, to sit, to watch, to learn, putting their hands in the water to bless themselves, listening to what was said, observing what was done, joining in the singing. It was really a catechesis for all those children. At my own parish, at one Sunday Mass, the naked infant was lifted from the font and held high as we sang, Alleluia. She was later carried in the recessional by the presider as we all rejoiced with this beautiful moment in the life of our parish. These were solemn celebrations, at times with the font itself given new prominence, always with music, always with a gathered community. Now, I know not all baptisms are that way because I've been to others, but this sense of recovery of the meaning of baptism I see in these family stories. Perhaps the fullest expression of this new consciousness is the celebration of baptism at the Easter Vigil, at the conclusion of the RCIA process. These rituals are actions of the entire gathered community. Music and flowers accent the importance of the moment. There is deep intentionality. The catechumens, the sponsors, the RCIA team, the community itself have shared in a slow journey, a journey of conversion, a journey in growth in understanding of baptism as a dying with Christ to one's own self and a rising to new life. Here, full, conscious and active participation come to full fruition and lead to a greater participation in the life and mission of the church. This changed consciousness, I believe, is part of what is influencing the developments in our church today relative to the role of the laity. As we compare the celebrations of the first part of the 20th century to those of the latter part and of our own century, we can see the flowering of the teachings of Vatican II, the centrality of baptism in Christian life, full conscious and active participation in the liturgy, the role of the entire community in our sacramental celebrations, and the role of music and art and symbolic gesture. This changed consciousness is present in the whole church. Priests who plan participative celebrations, architects who designed fonts so that they are once again central in our worship spaces, parents and family members who show up to celebrate, being there, recognizing this as an important moment. During these years, I have participated in many celebrations related to ordination. I've taught at the seminary for 28 years. I cannot count the number of diaconal and priestly ordinations I've attended, especially since at one point the Archbishop liked to spread the ordinations around to different parishes so that the whole class wasn't ordained to the diaconate together. A lot of ordinations. So I want to start, though, not with the ordinations, but my own childhood. In the 1950s, more than once, my parish had a newly ordained first mass. Processions were always part of the life of my Polish community, and those for these masses were rivaled only by the great Corpus Christi celebrations. The Corpus Christi celebrations included a procession to four altars placed around the entire block. Every society participated, each with a distinctive banner, ranks of altar boys, young girls in gowns, children in First Communion attire, they all slowly processed for the Corpus Christi procession and for the procession of the newly ordained. Pillows on which the paten and chalice were enthroned were carried. There was a joyous pealing of the bells. I still remember that wonderful sound, because the procession proceeded a full block down the street from the way that we started at the school and around the corner to the church. Sometimes in the church, the aisles were so full that periodically everything stalled. So a great and joyous celebration. And what of the conferring of holy orders? These are indeed solemn celebrations. A long procession of bishops, then priests. Joyous music in the soaring space of the cathedral. The symbol-laden ceremonies themselves are so richly evocative. Invocations, promises, vestings, prostrations, calling on the saints of long ago and those of today, receiving of symbols of office. At times, these ceremonies have taken my breath away, both with their solemnity and their import. These rituals, too, have been shaped by Vatican II. In fact, the permanent diaconate, as you know, was born because of that council. I wish I could ask David Power for his reflection on these post-council rituals of baptism and orders. What would he say? He had said, when we celebrate baptism with the same solemnity as orders, then this full consciousness of the meaning of baptism will emerge in our church. I wonder what would happen if baptism were celebrated with much greater solemnity than it is today. What greater changes in the consciousness of the laity would gradually take place as ritual, as symbol, did their work of shaping the religious imagination? That work is more powerful than words. Symbol reaches more deeply into the heart of human persons. Might this change more effectively create missionary disciples than words alone can do? Might the laity grasp more fully the way in which we have died and risen with Christ, to live now in him, to carry on his work? These questions implicitly inform the next section of my reflection, the emergence of lay ecclesial ministry. Where did the lay ecclesial ministers come from? I deeply believe that they arose from the heart of the church, and that it was the Second Vatican Council that initiated this gift. This conviction initially formed when I listened to my students, young men and women embarked on a path preparing for professional ministry. My dissertation and then my work, New Ecclesial Ministry, Lay Professionals Serving the Church, were my first attempts to explore the implications of this new development. To do so, I traced the multiple factors involved in calling lay men and women into professional ministry. The work of the individuals themselves, who often had served first as volunteers in ministry. Actually, at the beginning, the word ministry was not used. That doesn't emerge until after 1976. But the individuals themselves are part of this story. The invitations from pastors. It was pastors who invited people into ministry, professional ministry in the church. Pastors recognizing the pastoral need that was there and therefore taking initiative in this way. There were the work of the parish councils and committees that defined the roles that were needed in parishes that after the pastor identified this possibility. The formation programs that were offered by dioceses, colleges, universities, and seminaries. You have a significant offering here in terms of the MDiv for seminarians and lay students. I also noted the involvement of groups such as the Canon Law Society, already in 1972, pondering this reality. excuse me, professional organizations of ministers, liturgists, theologians, all of whom reflected on this sign of the times and tried to understand the development in light of our tradition. What does it mean? What does it mean that these lay people have come forward in this way? There was no single cause. There was no directive from church authority, not in the local church, not in the universal church. The church as a whole brought this forth at the grassroots. The development probably began around 1965. In 1980, the bishops, in a document commemorating the 15th anniversary of the proclamation of the decree on the apostolate of the laity, for the first time mentioned this phenomenon. Very brief, few sentences. They said in part, growing numbers of lay women and men preparing themselves professionally to work in the church. Ecclesial ministers represent a new development. We welcome this as a gift to the church. So that initial official recognition came about something that was already happening, that was already there. The numbers of lay ecclesial ministers grew rapidly. The first major study sponsored by the bishops was done by Father Philip Murnian in 1992, and then in 1997 repeated. He said, the number of lay ministers, that is, religious and lay in pastoral roles and paid for at least 20 hours a week, has increased by 35% in those 5 years, from 21 plus thousand in 92 to 29 plus thousand in 1997. Today, according to the CARA statistics, there are nearly 39,600 lay ecclesial ministers in the United States, nearly double the number of the first counting in 1992. But it's important to note that these statistics do not have the precision that exists relative to priests, relative to permanent deacons. We know when a priest becomes a priest. We know when a deacon becomes a deacon. There's no such clarity relative to lay ecclesial ministers. In addition to that, different dioceses use that language in different ways. In the Archdiocese of Chicago, one is only a lay ecclesial minister if, well, this was Cardinal George's practice, who is now deceased, as you know, but they only become a lay ecclesial minister when they are called and sent by the cardinal. Okay, that was his practice. There are many directors of religious education, youth ministers, liturgists in his diocese who are not so called and sent, so they're not counted in that diocese as lay ecclesial ministers, whereas in neighboring dioceses they are. So it's a somewhat muddled area. It's not fully defined. In part, my book, New Ecclesial Ministry, reports the result of a survey of lay people employed in professional roles in parishes, which I had conducted in 1985. To my knowledge, it was the first national survey that was done. One statistic is particularly relevant for our consideration here today. Quote, the new ministers think that the authority they need to exercise their roles is delegated to them and accepted by the parishioners. They also state that they function as leaders in their settings. When asked to rank in order what gives them their authority for their work in the church, they responded, baptism and confirmation, and there was a strong preference for that compared to the other possibilities that were offered to them. Professional training and competence were ranked second and third. No, excuse me, professional training and competence ranked second, and a vocation ranked third. But what they saw as most important was baptism. The baptismal consciousness that was there in their minds is, I think, a significant thing to note. It is already a flowering of the council. Clearly, for the majority of these ministers, baptism and confirmation was central, as I just said. However, when I reviewed Called and Gifted, the document that the bishops published 15 years after and then Called and Gifted for the third millennium, another 15 years later, I noted that while call is given significant prominence, baptism is not. The most definitive work of the United States bishops on this reality, co-workers in the vineyard of the Lord, begins with a beautiful reflection on the call to all believers, the call to the lay faithful, the call to lay ecclesial ministry. That section has proven immensely meaningful to many lay ecclesial ministers, an affirmation of their role in the church and of their call to ministry. Discussing discernment of this call to lay ecclesial ministry, the bishops state, quote, among the baptized, all of whom are called to serve the mission of the church, some experience a further specific call to lay ecclesial ministry. This is the only significant mention of baptism in that document. So what I realized, and I had not paid attention to this until I was reviewing these documents in light of the topic I was asked to address, is that the concept of call, of vocation, has superseded the centrality of baptism in explaining the role of lay ecclesial ministers in the church. I suspect that part of the reason for this is that for both priests and vowed religious, the discernment of their vocation has been so central in their lives, for deacons as well, and therefore gradually it has been emphasized by and in reference to lay people. You might ask, what difference does it make? Vocation is a rich theological spiritual concept, one honored in the life of the church, one that many lay ecclesial ministers state is their experience of call, of vocation. Nonetheless, I see three reasons to favor our baptism as the more central reality, not to ignore the importance of vocation, but to look at baptism as the central reality. First, it accords with the emphasis of the early church. In fact, for the church of the first millennia. Second, it is more deeply ecclesial, a more radically communal experience and concept. And third, it reminds us that as Christians, we enter into the suffering, indeed the death of Jesus. I've already explored the centrality of baptism in the life of the early church, but let's think together about these other two reasons. We live in an age and a culture where individualism is predominant. That book a number of years ago, Bowling Alone, right? That sense of individualism so strong in our culture and in the West. There is much that can be celebrated when we note the ways in which the individual is valued in our society. The laws that protect, the schools that foster personal growth, for example, in critical thinking rather than rote learning, and an ongoing flowering of innovation that occurs out of this individualism of our culture. However, many forms of community life are significantly weakened, including that of our own parishes. Although as a church we emphasize that personal vocation must be both personally and communally discerned, it seems that the interior, personal, individual dimension of vocation is given more attention. This is even more true in the programs that educate and form lay persons, because for the most part, there is no formal ecclesial process for affirming lay vocations. The vocation to priesthood is affirmed in the call to priesthood, to diaconate in the call to diaconate. There is no formal ecclesial process in most places for affirming lay vocations. Unlike vocation, baptism, both ritually and in our theological understanding of it, is communal. It is an act of the ecclesial community. Parents, what do you want of the church? Priests, I baptize you. Godparents and gathered family, and at times the assembly, an act of the community. Individualism can lead us to valuing my ministry and my vision for the community, whereas baptism roots us within the people of God whom we serve and the particular community in which we minister. In baptism, we are baptized into the death of Jesus. We enter the tomb with him. We enter into the suffering of Jesus. I believe that this belief has particular cogence today. Earlier this month, I attended the annual conference of the National Association for Lay Ministry. Most of our time was given to working in groups, considering the document Co-Workers in the Vineyard of the Lord, which is anniversary 10 years this coming November. Relative to each section of the document, we pondered two questions. What is working? What is not working? Okay. The table conversations lent themselves to the telling of personal stories. Too often, stories of pain and anger. They echoed stories I have been hearing in recent years. You know, I am sure, some of the scenarios. A new pastor and people lose their positions. A new bishop and long-standing ministry formation programs are discontinued. A significant increase in the number of deacons in a particular local church, which is cause for celebration, but at the same time, a parallel decline in the number of lay ecclesial ministers because they are being replaced by the permanent deacons. Cutbacks, sometimes radical cutbacks of diocesan staffs as a result of the financial impact of the clergy abuse crisis and the 2008 Great Recession. Lay ecclesial ministers who are living out their commitment to continue the ministry that Jesus began, who have a consciousness of their call to ministry, who see themselves as missionary disciples, suffer deep hurt when they can no longer minister as they had, or when they see fellow ministers in this situation. In light of this reality, I think that remembering that baptism is a dying with Christ can give solace, can give strength, can give meaning to these events. Some current developments. In recent years, there have been many positive developments relative to lay ecclesial ministry. And yes, there are many that are not positive, but I'm not going to address those today. But I invite your reflection on just these few positive developments. A leader in the conversation about lay ecclesial ministry has been St. John's School of Theology Seminary in Collegeville. They have sponsored two national symposia, one in 2007 and one in 2011, drawing together hundreds of leaders of lay associations and organizations and diocesan offices, as well as academics and others with expertise on the topic. They also sponsored a second seminar of theologians. The ultimate goal of each of these gatherings, that was in addition to the one I referenced with David Power earlier. Ed Hannenberg, who was here, was part of the second symposium. The ultimate goal of each of these gatherings was that theologians and practitioners be in active conversation, that theologians who study deeply the tradition be in conversation with people who at the grassroots are living the tradition in ways that are faithful to it and in ways that are new and need to be explored and understood. A key conclusion from these symposia and the seminar was, lay ecclesial ministers serve in the name of the church. In fact, the book that came from this is called In the Name of the Church. And that's something important to ponder, that the minister does not speak for herself or himself, but speaks in the name of the church. That's a new understanding that we are trying to explore more fully today in the church. This concept is further explained, quote, the call to lay ecclesial ministry is rooted in the baptismal call to holiness and mission that is incumbent on every believer. Lay ecclesial ministers receive a further call to serve formally and publicly on behalf of the church. Formally and publicly on behalf of the church. It is because of this formal and public role in the name of the church that the question of the authorization of lay ecclesial ministers is so important. Baptism alone does not authorize people to serve in the name of the church. The church must affirm this role and authorize this role. As a follow-up to the 2011 symposium, a study on the topic of authorization was commissioned by the Canon Law Society and conducted by CARA. It reports that while co-workers identified authorization as one of the four aspects of pastoral applications, almost 4 in 10 of respondents to the survey say that their archdiocese has no process for authorizing lay ecclesial ministry, 38%. Okay. Linda Robitaille, a Canadian canonist, sees the process of authorization as essential if lay ecclesial ministry is to indeed be an official ministry of the church. She suggests that canon law could be of great value in clarifying the rights and obligations, the duties and roles of lay ecclesial ministers. The structure she proposes is that of office. Following existing canon law, a bishop could establish an office, or more than one, for his diocese. For example, there could be an office of lay ecclesial ministry, or there could be an office of leaders of faith formation, or those are the two I pulled up. One value would be that the ministry would be emphasized. Okay, the ministry would be emphasized rather than the person in the ministry. I'm not a canonist, but I'm quite excited with the fact that the Canon Law Society intends to examine this question and work with the survey that they commissioned. In addition to the work done in the Collegeville seminars, Edward Hannenberg's Ministry of Relational Approach has provided additional insights into the theology of lay ecclesial ministry. He builds on the image of concentric circles of ministerial groups developed by Thomas O'Meara and develops his central point of ministerial relationships. This brief quote doesn't do justice to it, but ministers are not primarily isolated individuals whose relationships of service are secondary or non-essential to their existence as ministers. Instead, one becomes a minister by entering into and being established in relationships of service. In a theology of ministry, relationship, qualified as a relationship of service, is the ultimate category. What I find so helpful here is that it's we as Christians are a people. We as Christians are a body of Christ. And this way of thinking about lay ecclesial ministers, of ministry in general, emphasizes this relational dimension. And ministers themselves have been actively involved in assisting the flowering of lay ministry, not only individually, but by their cooperative action. One expression of this is the formation of the Alliance. Here we get into the church's alphabet soup, but I'll spell them all out. It's a collaboration of the Federation of Diocesan Liturgical Commissions, the National Association for Lay Ministry, the National Association of Pastoral Musicians, the National Conference for Catechetical Leadership, and the National Federation for Catholic Youth Ministry. Now, imagine these groups all coming to work together. It was years of effort in order to help develop a consensus. But what they have given us is the competencies for ministry, for lay ministry, the competencies that embrace all the different areas of lay ministry. Essentially, the competencies for the broad umbrella term lay ecclesial ministry. The work that they did to bring about the common competencies has been very important for institutions where people are being educated for ministry, because they have guidelines from the field as to what it is that people need to be able to know, to do, to be. Okay. In addition to the common competencies, in 2011, they gained approval of their national certification standards and procedures from the USCCB Commission on Certification and Accreditation. Like lay ministry, this is something from the grassroots. Like lay ministry, this is something that's coming from the people who are closest to the ground in terms of laity serving in ministry in the church. Those are just a few of what I see as important developments today. So in conclusion, the title that was proposed for this talk referenced lay ecclesial ministry as a flowering of baptismal witness. My intention today was to say that this flowering has indeed been nourished by the waters of baptism, and that a deeper consciousness of the centrality of baptism will support an even fuller growth, and one not only for lay ecclesial ministers, but also, as I know Bishop Tobin addressed last night, for laity in general in their role as leaven in the world. I've also wanted to indicate that as in its initial emergence, these flowers continue to be nurtured and tended by many in the church community. Lay ecclesial ministry is precisely ecclesial, communal, and as our bishops have affirmed, quote, has emerged and taken shape in our country through the working of the Holy Spirit. I look forward to our conversation, your thoughts about the snapshots I presented, the concepts I presented, my personal experience that I have shared, and what yours is relative to this topic. So.
My name is Father.
Should I turn this off? Is John still here? Yes, because I'm going to use this one. Okay.
My name is Father Bob Negosi. I'm Holy Cross priest, but I worked for 10 years in the Diocese of San Bernardino, California, where lay people were being chosen to be have a pastoral ministry, well, to be coordinators of a parish, of parishes, replacing priests. And one of the problems that I saw, which seemed to be glaring, was that it seemed to be running the parishes as a business. For example, in one situation, the person took a vacation during Holy Week. and then at bishops' conferences or priest conferences, I would ask the question, well, who's responsible for the pastoral care of these parishes that have these pastoral coordinators? And not that they weren't competent to do pastoral ministry, but it seemed that that was not the understanding of what they did. And they would have what they call priest ministers, a priest who would simply minister. The question I have is it possible for lay persons such as these to administer baptism? I know that's been done certain places in Alaska, I understand, I think the Bishop of Memphis years ago, and then there was a pushback on that, but I just want to introduce that idea. If they are indeed given authority to represent the church, as you say, in pastoral ministry, this is what I understood you to say,
yes,
that they need this or they are given this, then... why couldn't they administer baptism, which would thus show to everybody that they are indeed are responsible for the pastoral care of people?
Let's see. Is this working? Yes, it is. Okay. Let me think about your question in a couple of different categories. First of all, the pastoral administrators that you were describing, I call them 517.2, that's the canon law, people, because the title varies so much in different parts of the country. The story you just told makes me sad because someone didn't recognize the importance of his or her role in the pastoral care of that parish. I know there have been many programs that have educated and prepared people who fill this role, and in many places, the report is that they fulfill them well. They're theologically grounded, they're pastorally trained, and they fulfill the role well. However, I don't put my focus there when I talk about lay ecclesial ministry. They would be included, but their ministry is, as using the language from Pope John Paul II's Christopher Delis Laici, their ministry is by supply. Because there are not, this is my theological stand on this, because there are not sufficient priests to lead all of the communities, that they have been appointed so that communities, community life can be maintained. I think it's by exception. There, at most, there were never more than about, I had these statistics, there were never more than about 700 people serving in that way. They are not the people that I'm talking about. I'm talking about the 39,000 who serve in other roles in parishes. So that's one piece there. I'm a little amused the memories that come back to you all of a sudden. My grammar school class came back to me that in a case of an emergency, I could baptize a baby, and that has been the teaching of the church. But you're talking about something very different, about the celebration in a parish. My understanding is, and I don't have precise knowledge here, but my understanding is that whenever a pastoral coordinator, a 517.2 person is appointed, there is a priest who is responsible for the sacramental life. And I presume the priest would be the one who would baptize, but someone could correct me on that if I'm not right. But I think your question will provoke further thought for me, and I thank you for it. So.
My name is Father Mike Kieber. I'm a pastor of a large Hispanic parish outside of Minneapolis. And my question is, what do you do with lay ecclesial ministry coming or having served in a diocese in disarray?
Yes.
And so at a parish level, what should I be trying to do if I don't find that leadership in the archdiocese? Would it be important for me to recognize in a formal ceremony, for example, the lay ecclesial ministers that I currently have? How important is that? What kind of practical suggestions would you give to a pastor, particularly in a Latino community?
My experience with Latino communities is somewhat limited, but I have had a wonderful experience a couple of years ago of visiting a number of Latino parishes in Los Angeles, and the vibrancy there was evident. So I'm presuming that there is a vibrancy. One of the difficulties that's being discussed today is relative to Hispanic ministers is this. The bishops have outlined an extensive program that people should have to be lay ecclesial ministers, education, formation. It leans toward, but never says, master's level training. But in the Hispanic community, only 17% of Hispanics have a BA. So it's unrealistic to use that kind of a norm. And therefore, you have dual questions to work with. And the one is, who are the lay ecclesial ministers? Who will you name as the lay ecclesial ministers in your diocese, since you don't have a program such as Chicago has? And I think there are two categories to think about. One is, of course, background education, diocesan workshops, little diversion. I started working in a parish in 1969. That year, there were four of us in that town who began, and we were the first DREs in Bridgeport Diocese in Connecticut. Three of us had degrees in master's degrees in theology, religious education. One didn't have a BA, but Rose had attended every single thing the diocese had ever offered. She was the kindergarten teacher, the school closed, and the pastor said, well, you will be the DRE, okay? A couple years later, we were forming a professional organization, and we said, well, who is a professional? And we decided the professional was one who was named as a professional by other professionals, and we named Rose as being part of our group because she had the competence, she had the passion, she had the respect in the parish, she had everything that was needed to do a very good job with what she did. So some discernment of who you would want to recognize in an official way. And that often in non-dominant culture communities, such as the Hispanic community, leadership emerges in a different way than through degrees. It's more charismatically evident, okay? And I once did a workshop, and a woman sat in the front row who was dressed in African kinto cloth. She had a lovely turban and a beautiful dress. And at one point, she spoke, and she said that, you know, when we talk about authority, when we talk about legitimacy for leadership, she said, I have a PhD, and in my academic community, I'm respected for that. And then she slid into African style of speech, but in my community, I can't do it. In my community, on a Sunday, they don't care about my degree. They care that the Spirit works in me and that I can help them in their life as a church. Well, that was a wonderful moment for me. And I think that's what you have to be thinking about there. And ritually, there are all kinds of ways. We have Catechist Sunday for the catechists. It always struck me as odd that the DREs had no parallel blessing from the community, authorization by the community. I used to work with a sister, and she was responsible for the DREs in the Archdiocese of New York, and she said, the problem is people think she's just Mrs. So-and-so. I always remember that, just Mrs. So-and-so. How to help people think, no, she's not just Mrs. So-and-so. She is authorized by me, the pastor, to do this work. And so I don't know if that helps. Okay, but I really like your question. So, okay. Okay. Why don't you start since you're there, and then someone's moving in that direction.
Doctor, I'm not sure. I'm not that smart to actually follow a paper read, but I think what you're saying is, is this ecclesial lay movement that I didn't even understand what it meant when the bishop said it last night. I'm a priest in the Diocese of Toledo.
Okay.
And but I guess the ecclesial, you're talking about DREs. I guess you're talking about principals, you know, and youth ministers and people. So I think what you're saying, I think, is that this has come up by the Spirit informally, and now there's a need to make it more formal to be able to have some kind of authorization from the church, just as ordination for deacons and priests makes us officially speaking for the church. So then there's a need for the ecclesial lay ministers to have more, you know, formality that they're kind of given an official authority of the church, but then if we make them another institutional being, are we going to be able then to only hire those people and then be able to cut off the legs of the informality that the Spirit was allowed to move with them in the first place?
For someone who said that it's difficult to follow a talk, you've just given an abstract that could be put at the top. You could put that at the top of
Because the whole thing, then I'm going to have to pay this much money and to get them, and then are they going to become another talking head?
Right.
And is Mrs. So-and-so really effective because she's not so academically trained? Because it's all about language.
Right.
And the fact is, my God, if I'm, you know, being ordained, have a hard time following these presentations in this conference, I mean, then how do we reach people with the gospel?
Okay.
Like that lady, that woman, sorry, I didn't mean lady, that person said last night was so great. She said, are you given anything in your homily so I, as a mother or a father, can be able to teach my kids?
Yes.
And so I think that's the rub.
Right.
That it's true, though.
Okay.
It all depends probably on the leadership.
Yes.
Some pastors would say, you know what, I'll make sure you get educated and you have our backing. And it's true that these people working should have backing from the church. But then are we just gonna create another layer of hierarchy to be able to get us so out in touch with the people and what we really need to do? Because now I can just hire whoever, especially in those parishes where they don't have the money to hire someone.
Right.
So I don't know if I'm close, but.
Okay. In her introduction, Stacy mentioned that I worked for 10 years as an advisor to the Bishop's Subcommittee on Lay Ministry that eventually gave us the document, Co-Workers. What you were just naming was part of what they struggled with. It was part of what they asked. It was a wonderful subcommittee because they worked so hard. 3 times a year, 6 hours or 3 hours meetings, but in addition to that, numerous consultations with priests, deacons, theologians, lay ecclesial ministers themselves, canon lawyers, convocations and convocations in order to learn what was happening and to ask what was their role as bishops in relation to this. It's a difficult question because the final statement is what I would call very soft. They really do not define lay ecclesial ministry. A definition makes a circle, and you're within the definition or outside the definition. That did not happen with co-workers. And in part, it's because they don't want to define it too, not define, yes, they don't want to define this too soon. They don't want to take actions that are too stringent. Everything in the document is presented as a guideline, not as particular law. There's nothing that's binding in co-workers. It's a very worthwhile document. It's not too long. Is it out here in the book supply? Okay. It's easy to get from the USCCB website. But if you're pondering these questions in relation to your own parish, it's a short read, and it's written in American English. I once had someone point out years ago in one of my classes about a Roman document, you know, can't they learn to write in American English? but it's an important point that you're raising, that we don't want to do it too soon. When Phil Murnian did his first study in 1992, he made four general conclusions, and one of them was that this development is local. Phil was the head of the National Pastoral Life Center, and before that, the head of the bishop's center for the parish. He was a deeply committed parish person, as priest and as sociologist and as thinker about the church. And one of the conclusions he made, this is local. This is local. It's pastors who are bringing this forth. Now, since then, that was 1992, he was the only other person with me who served the full time, the 10 years, and I miss Phil. But the progress that the bishops were making was trying to take account of, this is still growing, this is still flowering, we don't want to encase it too soon. Does that help? So, but I assure you, you had what I said right on. yes.
I'm Deb Organ. I'm from the Archdiocese of St. Paul in Minneapolis, and I'm 35 years a lay ecclesial minister. I noticed when you were speaking that my trajectory of formation and development basically followed the opening to lay ministry in the United States context. Yes. Much of my time as a lay ecclesial minister has been spent ministering cross-culturally in Latino communities, and that's, that remains true today. And I think I'll always be grateful that I began my life of ministry in a time when there was a lot of openness to collaboration. I was encouraged to receive formation and education, and I was invited into collaborative ministry contexts. And I can't say enough in gratitude to the people upon whose shoulders I stand. We're in a different moment now. And I think over those 35 years that one of the things that I've learned that's most important is that I, as a minister within a community, have to be grounded enough to be able to sit in the kind of ambiguity that we're in many of our local churches and in our national church as well, to be able to be in a place that's free enough for us together, hopefully, to use our imaginations in order to deal with situations that are in flux and that are changing, and especially when we're surrounded by so much fear. I want to give an example of something, a fantastic use of imagination in our local church in St. Paul in Minneapolis on the part of some of my colleagues at one of the Catholic universities. They have a pretty big theology department, and noted through contact with people working in pastoral life in our Latino communities that many times there isn't formation available for leaders in Latino communities, particularly not in Spanish. And so what this university did was they decided to underwrite 100% a 20-credit certificate program in pastoral ministry in Spanish. And they're now bringing in their second cohort of 23 people to train, to recognize people who are serving in the role of leadership in their communities and give them the formation that they need so that we can continue to imagine and live into the real church that we have around us, before our eyes, and within us right now. This is something that is creating change in our local church, and we really need to lean into that. We're having a little bit of a tough time in our local church right now. So I think my point is that we're in a new reality. We're in the church that I'm serving now is not the same one that I came into as a young minister in many respects, and yet somehow it is also the same. Mm-hmm. And so continuing to use all that we have together to live into what is now, to deal with the real limitations, to confront the real fears, and to try to be what we are as a church, a place of, as Archbishop Tobin said last night, of encounter with one another and with the living God. So, thank you.
Thank you for that very inspired reminder to us, and the reality that you are naming of this time that in many ways is difficult. Someone said to me recently that we are celebrating the Francis effect, and our hearts are so lifted by so much that the Holy Father is being and doing and saying, but it hasn't fully penetrated our life at the local level. And yet there is life. And I think I very deliberately developed, rather briefly, but that theme of dying with Christ, of suffering with Christ. It puts the reality in a context that is, the cross is there, and sometimes we encounter it directly in our lives in ways that I certainly, when I was first, I started in 69 in a parish, didn't envision the difficulties that would emerge. So thank you. And I'd lift up one word that was emphasized, and that was collaboration. It is the working together of the ministers in the community, the priests, the deacons, and the lay ecclesial ministers, that is so central to ministry succeeding, of not fracturing the community through not having good collaboration. And so I would lift up that word from your comments. So please.
Can you explicitate just a bit the connection between what you said, I think very eloquently and affirmingly, about lay ecclesial ministry and the implications of that circumstance in our, you know, contemporary church for preachers, day to day, week to week,
yes,
giving the homily at daily mass or Sunday? Help us to make that link a little more explicit.
Okay, would you say your name again?
Oh, yeah, I'm Dan Luby. I'm from the University of Dallas School of Ministry.
Okay. I think I've met you.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, Dan. Thank you. I was very aware that this was a preaching conference and that I didn't refer to preaching. In fact, I mentioned that this morning to Father Connors. Your words in preaching are very important. Your words in affirming, as was picked up from last night, the emphasis on the lives of people and how the gospel speaks to their lives is very important. But I have increasingly come to believe that more important than the words are the actions, the symbols, the shaping of the religious imagination. And I think the points that I made about the ways baptism is sometimes celebrated, that makes clear the role of the whole community, that makes clear that this is the church together. Someone is being baptized into the church, being made part of the community. That is of great importance. And the way that we celebrate, the way that those of you who are priests and deacons preside at sacramental celebrations, that preaches. And I give as support of what I'm saying, Pope Francis. And a lot of what the Pope is preaching is in the spirit of Francis, the first Francis, St. Francis. Preach always, if necessary, use words. So I don't mean to step away from that really good question, Dan, but what I wanted to emphasize today was the first. But the second is, here I can do better with the ministry of the laity as leaven, the ministry of those who are not the lay ecclesial ministers, but to help think about all the roles that people fulfill in parishes and to lift them up as to how they are important, of how they contribute to the kingdom of God, of how they contribute to, as John Paul would say, the transformation of the social order. And to really give thought to who are the people in your congregation and what kind of work do they do. I followed a lot of the stories of individuals that came out of the destruction of the World Trade Center. I live right in that area. And so I remember the one story that on the Monday after the attack, Wall Street was reopening. And there was a man who was sweeping. And he said, "This is my job, to get this place ready so those guys can come back and get our country back on track." Now, there was a certain vocational awareness there in this simple action that his work was important. And I followed a lot of the stories at that time of people who, out of what they did in life, the guy who's watching television and seeing the search dogs on the, you know, at the mound, was a vet and came with the little booties you can put on the feet of the dogs so that they could do their work. The massage therapist who came and set up at the boat in the harbor there so that people who were working the weeks afterward could come and have a break. The consciousness of what we do for the good of the community is often implicit in the lives of people, but not made explicit in our church community. And I think it's not so much the lay ecclesial ministers that I think need to be preached about as the others. I never did this when my sisters and my brother were raising their children, but I'm so much more aware now with my nieces and my nephews. And when I can, I will speak to something. I'll say, "Yeah, I saw that you were trying to work out that conflict between the two kids, and it's not easy. And that's why marriage is a school of holiness. Family life is a school of holiness." You know? That trying to pay attention to what the people are investing their lives in, I think that would be the way that I would see of our preachers helping us. So, but also, I can tell you, when Father Richard in my parish baptized that baby that way and walked out, he walked holding the baby up down the aisle afterward, that was preaching too, of this life in our community, this life coming into our community, this importance of this baptism, and everybody rejoiced. So, okay. But is it time?
Thank you. We'll take a break now, but let's thank our speaker again for this morning.